one has it.
Mountains hold an almost mystical fascination. Spend any time here and the rest of the world simply seems to vanish. It's just you and the mountain. That sense of release is very hard to beat, but if you get it wrong, you can very quickly find yourself in trouble.
I was at the point where I didn't know that we would make it alive, and I didn't know how long I'd have the use of my hands, so I just decided to write this letter while I still could. My darling wife, Mary, how I grieve at leaving you behind. You have been more than a best friend, a great lover, fantastic mother. You have been that special person in my life who I could always count on, who I knew would always be there no matter what.
The words of Mike Couillard, an American Air Force officer, who after taking one wrong turn on the ski slopes, spent the next 9 nights with his young son exposed on the side of the mountain. A situation he was able to deal with after only a few hours of classroom survival training. We'll return to Mike's story a little later on. But with so many people now visiting the mountains, his experience is a lesson to us all. Sometimes a little knowledge can go a long way. I'm in the Alps. The biggest ski area in the world is in the next valley, but I might as well be thousands of miles away because this is a protected national park. And that means no ski lifts, no mechanized transport, just pristine wilderness. Of all the wilderness places, mountains are the most difficult to dress for. One minute it's sunny, the next it's a blizzard. Getting your clothing right is vital. And to help demonstrate, we've brought along Arthur. The key is to think in layers. So you can remove layers when you're sweating up a slope, and add them if you're standing still and getting cold. It's common sense, it just takes a little forethought and planning. But if you want to get really serious about moving around, then you need some serious equipment and a qualified mountain guide. They spend years learning how to deal with everything the mountains can throw at them. I love the challenge of a new peak.
So it's great to be able to come climbing. My old friend Nick Parks, we haven't climbed together in 15 years. Been a long while, eh, Nick? Oh, hard work getting up there.
The mountains are a fantastic environment. I love every moment in them, but one has to remember that it is an extremely dangerous environment too. We're just constantly on our lookout for all the hazards that exist, and our job is risk management in the mountains. Very often people do underestimate the dangers that do exist. Travelling through the mountains is a constant question of hazard evaluation. Looking at the snowpack, constantly watching the weather, how much sun has been on the slope, which direction the wind's coming from.
Because in the mountains, in winter, there's always the threat of avalanches. Cross the wrong slope at the wrong time of day, and you could be in serious trouble, as these three skiers found out. Incredibly, they all survived.
If you're caught by a slide, as the snow begins to settle, as you feel the whole thing coming to a halt, that's when you've got to make the big effort to fight for the surface, trying to create an air pocket, to give yourself a chance to be able to breathe for a while, because suffocation is probably the number one killer.
To try and show you what's involved in an avalanche rescue, the crew are simulating just such an accident. At the foot of this avalanche slope, they've buried Arthur somewhere. Now, we've done a visual search to start with, and we can't see any sign of him. No feet, no legs or arms or anything sticking out. So we're going to have to conduct a more thorough search. Now, bear in mind, the first 15 minutes are critical because most people die within that time. So we're his best chance of rescue. We're taking with us three pieces of equipment. Shovel to dig with, snow probe to feel through the snow with, and most importantly of all, We're all wearing one of these, an avalanche transceiver.
It sends out a signal like a beacon while you're wearing it, but it can be switched over easily to a receiver and guide you to anyone buried. Using it can cut the search time to under 3 minutes, and that's the difference between life and death.
3 meters, Nick. 2.8. 2.5, bit left. 2.3. We're on top of him. The probe's really important. Because with that...
Can you pinpoint it a bit more?
Yeah. 1.2 here.
I've got him. I'm sure that's him.
The probe enables Nick to feel through the snow for the body so that we can dig in exactly the right area. He could be in any depth of snow. You know, devices like these avalanche transceivers are transforming wilderness safety. Today, it's only a fool who goes into the mountains in winter without
one. Something.
The most important thing to expose, first of all, is the victim's mouth. We were lucky we came straight to the head because you've got to get air to him. The second most important thing is to turn off his transceiver in case there's someone else you're still looking for.
But there's not just avalanches to deal with. There's the cold and the snow.
There you go, Arthur. Get caught in the mountains in a bad storm, then you may have to take shelter. Now, in those circumstances, the snow itself can be your best friend.
3 meters, 3.5 meters.
3.5 meters?
Yeah.
What we're doing here is creating a steep bank to dig into. Now, normally you'd look for just that sort of location. But unfortunately, because of the high avalanche risk, we're going to have to dig it out like this. Well, one tool that really makes it easier is a saw. It can be an ordinary wood cutting saw like this, or a special snow saw either. Because when you cut blocks, you move vast amounts of snow for far less effort, which means you save energy to keep you warm in your snow hole. Like that. Well, now we've created a face, we can start to construct our snow hole. One advantage, mind you, of digging this hole is we're already out of the wind and gaining some shelter. Now, the type of shelter we're going to build is quite a classic snow cave. It has a T shape. So first, I have to dig out a column here, which will become like a corridor into the snowbank. And on either side, the top of the T will form two sleeping platforms, which go into the hillside. And again, although you can dig this all out with a shovel, it's one of those jobs where a saw cuts the work to a third. Now you may be wondering how I'm going to get this block out, but actually you can do most of the work with a saw by cutting wedges.
They could get quite into this, couldn't they?
The roof needs to be curved and as smooth as possible so that you don't get dripping off of any little peaks, making you wet and cold.
Time for the door, eh?
Yeah, we'll make the vent hole first.
Smooth enough, isn't it?
Well, we've virtually completed the snow cave now. At this stage, you're already getting the benefit of the shelter because we're well out of the wind and the snow. We've created two sleeping platforms like this here, and this gap in between isn't just to help us get in and out, it's also to collect cold air. It's called a cold well or a cold sink. So the warmth is here, the cold sinks down, and we sleep more comfortably. one of the most important features is this, the air vent. Whenever you're in one of these snow caves, snow shelters, they're virtually airtight and carbon monoxide builds up, which is toxic. So you've always got to have an air vent. And to make sure that stays clear and working, we need to be able to clean it from inside in case snow accumulates outside.
Oh, Top Gun.
A candle gives a little warmth, and a flickering flame can be a useful warning that there may not be enough oxygen. Although these shelters shrink a little every day, climbers can sit out storms in them in relative comfort for days until the weather clears and they're able to move on. But the higher you go and the faster you go up, the more at risk you are from altitude sickness.
The name given to the common symptoms we all get is acute mountain sickness, and in a way it's a misnomer, because acute implies that it's going to come on very suddenly, whereas it often develops first with a delay at altitude. You go up to 3,500 meters, you feel fine when you get there, and then next day you begin to feel rotten.
Generally it's a mild illness with flu-like symptoms.
It only really becomes a worry because of its serious complications. Either the brain fills up with fluid, which is called cerebral edema, or the lungs fill up with fluid, which is called pulmonary edema. And both these are life-threatening. One of the remarkable things about these conditions is they get better very quickly. If you can drop down even 300 metres, something like that, 1,000 feet, people recover.
50 years ago, climbers didn't have the benefit of all this knowledge, but medical advice is useless unless you choose to follow it.
Time and time again, you'll hear of people who develop a bit of pulmonary edema or a bit of brain edema, and they say, oh, we'll sit it out in this campsite, we won't go down, and that ends in disaster, that they become either extremely breathless and then, in a matter of a few hours, moribund. Or if they've got brain edema, they become unsteady, unreasonable, all the things that you do when you're drunk. Unlike the effects of alcohol, if you're suffering from coma, from brain edema, the chances of survival are relatively slim. But usually, you either die of acute mountain sickness complications or you make a complete recovery.
If you have to get out of the mountains in a hurry, one of the most useful tools is a rope with which to lower yourself down. But of course, the problem is finding something to tie it to, a belay point, when everything's covered in all this snow. Well, to answer that need, surprisingly, mountaineers will often resort to the snow itself, using snow in conjunction with their ice axe to create what they call a retrievable ice axe belay. First thing I'm going to do is stamp down this soft snow, because that has no strength in it at all. The next thing, I need to start to create a groove here in the stronger layers of snow, a little lower down. Be careful not to break its structure too much. I'm going to use two ice axes for this belay. Now here's the science bit. You need to join them together and anchor them in the snow in a T-shape. The rope is looped around them in such a way that to pull on one side releases the upright axe, pulling the other out with it. I have to be careful to maintain an even load on each half of the rope on my way down. The last thing I want to happen is for the belay to pull out halfway down the slope.
But there we go, I'm down safely and I've still got my ice axes. Now if this was a big slope, I might have to repeat the whole process two or three times to get down.
This technique's relatively simple in good conditions, but lenticular clouds like these mean changing weather, and in the mountains that can happen in minutes, catching you off your guard.
Which is what happened to Mike Couillard, an American Air Force pilot, and his son Matt when they decided to tackle the highest run on a skiing trip in Turkey. He didn't know it then, but he was about to rely on his limited survival training.
I was there on assignment with the Air Force for 2 years, and we were on a recreational ski trip in one of the few areas, really, in Turkey where you could go skiing. As we rode the lift up, snow was starting to fall, and I remember as we got off the lift, it was even heavier. It was just all of a sudden, you know, the snow started falling pretty heavy, and it got harder and harder to see very far.
Before long, they couldn't see more than a few feet, but despite that, they pressed on, breaking one of the most important rules of survival.
Stop. Don't move. I knew, I'm sure in the back of my mind, that I'm complicating any search effort. I think what drove me to that is I never planned to be the recipient of a search effort. I really thought we're going to find our way off that mountain on our own that first night.
They'd set off down the wrong side of the mountain, so instead of heading back towards safety, they were, in fact, heading further away from it. Now, they could have stopped and tried to retrace their tracks, but as so often happens in these situations, people go into a state of denial and head on regardless into the unknown. It's something I'm sure we've all experienced at one time or other.
But Mike was convinced he was going in the right direction.
For a 10-year-old, I think I pushed him pretty hard. He would fall in the snow from time to time, and I think sometimes, he admitted later, he fell in the snow just so I would stop and let him get a breath. Of course, I knew that we were fighting a battle of time. I wasn't worried until we stopped, and I knew we were going to spend the night on that mountain. And I think it was then that the full weight of the situation hit me. My son by now is shivering cold. His clothes are all wet, so I wanted something I could set up within about 30 minutes. And they taught us in survival school how to make shelters with existing things like a tree with wide open branches, and that's what I picked.
He'd been taught that you lose a lot of heat by conduction from your body to the ground, which is quite right. So in their shelter, he put down a very good layer of green boughs as insulation. Absolutely the right thing to do.
Despite his best efforts to make it weatherproof, they still spent a cold night under the tree. The next morning, Mike found a far better shelter, a hollow under a rock, just big enough for the two of them.
Had we not found that, we would have been probably a lot worse off. We would have suffered more frostbite, and more, you know, probably more verging on hypothermia.
Remember, Mike and Matt had set out for a day skiing. They weren't expecting to spend nights in the mountains, so they were working with hardly anything at all.
All they had to deal with their hunger was 5 sweets, and they were already into their third day.
Water was another matter. They were surrounded by snow, but they had no means of melting it. If you eat snow, you hasten the onset of hypothermia, because you're using your body's warmth to melt it, so you don't get really a great deal of return. Now, if they'd been able to light a fire, they could have used a technique like this. It's called the Finnish marshmallow. You take a block of compacted snow, prop it on a stick by the fire, so that it will drip eventually into a container. And for that, they could have simply used a ski boot.
Fortunately, we had a stream that was running right alongside this road that we were on. I knew that if I could get to the stream, I could bring him water.
Their need for water wasn't just about thirst. Water is vital to keep your circulation functioning, and that helps to stave off frostbite, which, after several days out on the mountain, was already setting in.
Our feet were fairly numb. In fact, I'd take almost 20 minutes to put these ski boots back on.
Frostbite is frozen flesh. The dilemma that you're in is whether to thaw it out or not, particularly if it's your feet, because If you do, they blister and swell up. If you keep them frozen, you can still walk on them. And so it's often better just to decide on the survival tactic. And provided you're not actually getting colder, the amount of damage you're going to do is probably not going to increase. If you do thaw your feet out, over the course of 4 or 5 days, you get huge blisters forming, followed by the tissue going all black. The only good news about frostbite is that it often gets a lot better than you think it's going to be. When we see fingertips that are blackened, the immediate reaction of the surgeon is have them off, clean it up, make it look nice. But you see quite remarkable degrees of recovery.
It's not so painful. Eventually, it's not painful at all because, the colder your feet get, the more sensation you lose.
A helicopter search had started almost immediately, but Mike and Matt had gone so far in the wrong direction, they were 18 miles away from the main search area. Day after day passed without rescue.
I had basically nothing other than I had a wallet with like a charge card that had a silvery surface to it that I was able to use like a mirror and signal with that. I knew I was doing everything I could possibly do to try to make myself seen by the helicopters that came overhead. To describe the emotions that go with that is almost impossible. It's a real bittersweet mixture of, hey, they're looking for us, and they didn't see us. At the seventh day point, I thought we were going to die, and there was a part of me that just sort of reconciled and resigned to that. But I feel like God spoke to my heart in a very graphic way, and it was that assurance that He was there with us that kind of kept me going.
But fearing the worst, he decided to write his feelings down in a letter.
About the eighth day into it, and I'm just thinking that our chances are less and less that we'll be found. And then to leave my last thoughts with the family. My darling wife Mary, how I grieve at leaving you behind. I hate to come to that conclusion, but after 8 days, I think, and the 3 helicopters that flew overhead, and despite my frantic waving, did not spot us, it seems more and more the path the Lord is calling us on. Matthew's been a real trooper. The hardest part of this whole ordeal is watching him suffer. He wants me to relay to all of you how much he loves his family. Mark, I am very proud to be your father. Thanks for your patience when I was less than nice. Marisa, you are a special person. I have not always known what to do with all your energy, and sometimes even the impulsive expressions of your love for me. I'm sorry, and let me say right now that I love you back. Mary, my heart and soul forever. Mike.
After 8 days on the mountain without rescue, Mike was faced with an impossible choice, either staying put and facing the near certainty that he and Matt would die under the rock, or leaving his son completely alone while he went to find help.
The worst decision I've ever had to face, before and since. I hope I never face a decision that difficult again.
He struggled to some huts several miles away, but by the time he got to them, he was utterly exhausted. To his despair, they were empty, and as darkness fell, he hadn't the strength to get back to Matt. Tormented by the thought that his son might be dying, all Mike could do was pray for him as his frostbite started to thaw.
If you can just imagine your worst sunburn that you've ever had and magnify that by 10 or 100 times, you're gonna get kind of close to what that feels like. That kept me awake, but then also I think the worry of what's Matthew going through in this cave, I think that kept me awake as much as anything else.
For 2 days, Mike was torn apart, haunted by fears for his son, but unable to move from the hut. Then miraculously, he heard a bus and knew it was their only chance of rescue.
I think time slows down, especially when you're wanting someone to help you. Eventually they approach me, and turns out it's not skiers at all, it's lumberjacks. Very rough-looking sort, didn't speak a word of English. And I'm thinking, well, I gotta tell these folks how to get to my son. I'd gotten 5 months of language training, so I was able to communicate pretty well. It was less than an hour later, he was on my lap. I can't describe those emotions. I mean, it's, I was just a ball of tears. And I was amazed, I guess, at what good condition he was in. I think I alluded to this. I had no idea. I just, after 2 days and nights, is he going to be not only a physical but an emotional basket case? I had visions of the worst, I think. And he was in great spirits, you know, just kind of, hi, Dad. As if, you know, we were just getting together over lunch or something. And so I was real proud. I can't describe the pride that I felt, too. This kid, you know, you always kind of think, well, my kids are pretty strong. But I had no idea that he could go through that and be as in good a condition as he was.
Incredibly, Mike and Matt survived 10 days on the mountainside, using only what they'd set out to ski in. Happily, they haven't been put off returning to the hills, though these days they carry plenty of food, warm socks and dry matches. They were able to survive due to their determination, their faith and just a few hours survival training in a classroom, which just goes to show how just a little bit of knowledge can go a very long way indeed.
Next week, surviving on a desert island, Robinson Crusoe style.